Hello, everyone, and welcome to a live dispatch from home. I am Patricia Butler, the CEO and co-founder of Artist Works, and I'm joined by three of our online teaching faculty today, master musicians, very interestingly, in bluegrass as well as jazz. So this is a very special dispatch from home, and I'm very excited to get started. And so we're going to talk a little bit about the cross section of jazz and bluegrass and where do they intersect, do they intersect, talk about improvisation and what these fine musicians have been up to in their storied musical careers. For those of you who don't know who Artist Works is, we are an online music instruction company and we work with 37 world-renowned musicians just like those three that are joining me today. And they've come into our studio and recorded a lot of what they know, if not all of it, so that they can teach you pretty much anything that you would like to play. But what is a little bit different about learning at Artist Works is that you can also submit a video to these great musicians and they will respond with a video of guidance to kind of help you get along your way to reach the goals that you've set for yourself. So you have a lot of lessons to learn from, and you can also learn from these video exchanges. And it's also kind of cool that you get to see everybody else's as well. So it's sort of like going into a classroom and hearing all of the questions that have been asked, as well as all the answers that have been given throughout time. So it's an interesting and different kind of learning experience at Artist Works, starting with these master musicians. I want to tell you also not to chew your ear, but we have a really terrific contest going on right now. And it's important that I tell you about this because it's a very unique situation. We are giving away 1 hour lessons, either in person or online. I'm assuming that's all going to be online, given the circumstances we're in, with any of our musicians. And you have only to sign up. And so I'm going to put that destination right there on the website. So you can go to artistworks.com/contest. This contest is ending on the 16th, but you can win a 60-minute private lesson one-on-one with any of our musicians, and you get a one-year membership to Artist Works in any course that you would like. But let's get started with some music now. We are going to begin this day with a beautiful tune called Gentle on My Mind. And so today we are joined by George Whitty on jazz piano, Mike Marshall on mandolin, and Bryan Sutton on flat pick guitar. So we're going to start now. Mike Marshall's going to kick off Gentle on My Mind.
All right. Hello, friends. Nice to be here. Hi, George. Hi, Bryan.
Hi, everybody.
And we it's knowing that we can't really jam live together at the same time, we've come up with somewhat of a solution. Each of us has created a rhythm track for us to play over, and Bryan Sutton created this beautiful guitar track that we're all three going to have a little chance to play over. So I'll go first. This is John Hartford's classic tune, Gentle on My Mind, with Bryan's rhythm guitar and me doing a little mandolin solo. Oops. Let's try that again. Sorry, folks. Thank you.
Bravo, maestro.
I'll add to the applause.
Yeah, that was great. Loved it. Do we want to continue to play some versions of this tune? And we can talk about you wonderful musicians after you've played through this?
I'd sure love to hear what each of these master musicians would throw down.
All right, Bryan, you want to go next?
I will go. I will play along with myself here on live on the internet.
George, you're up now.
Are we ready?
George Whitty, here he goes.
Lordy.
Here he goes.
Bluegrass Bobby.
Bravo in plural. Like, how do I say bravo?
Bravissimenti.
Bravos.
Okay. Bravos.
Bravi.
Bravi. Bravi. Yeah. You're Italian, Mike. You should know. Bravi.
Of course.
Bravi.
O becomes I.
Okay. Got it.
There you go.
Got
we have it. Some comments already coming
My
in.
First wow. lesson of the day. So before we do get to some of the comments and people saying hello, which we do want to get to because we have a lot of people that join us many times over and then some new folks as well. Let's talk a little bit about your careers and who you are. I will tell you that one of the reasons why I asked the three of you to come together is because a while ago when George and Eric Marienthal maybe were doing one of these live streams, George mentioned to me, you know, if there's ever an opportunity to do something with those bluegrass guys, I'd love to try. You know, let's talk about it and let's see if we can do some kind of imaginative collaboration. And since, you know, we kind of needed to get through this week for a couple of reasons before we could kind of think straight here. And now we're thinking straight and I'm happy to have George Whitty and Bryan Sutton and Mike Marshall here, three really masterful players. So since George, you were sort of the inspiration, could we start with you and just talk a little bit about your history? I know you're a Grammy and an Emmy Award winner, and I think that in itself is very interesting. Can you just give us a little bit of background on your career?
Yeah, well, you know, growing up in Coos Bay, Oregon, which was not a jazz mecca, I kind of grew up in the era where a whole lot of things were on the radio at once. And it was mostly kind of a diet of you know, pop music, but I always sort of gravitated to the stuff that had the great playing on it, even before I was serious about being a musician. And, you know, Glenn Campbell, it's hard to beat that. It's hard to beat the tracks, the singing, you know, what beautiful writing, and so forth. But once I kind of got a hold of Kind of Blue, the Miles Davis record, that was sort of the die was cast. But all along the way, I was listening to all these different fusions of things. I mean, any Weather Report record has, you know, 10, 12 different ethnicities per cut. And I always just loved that. That to me is the spirit of jazz and improvisation, is not just playing a different line or making up a line over a walking bass and drums that are going like this. It's you know, can we come up with a completely different feel, and can we come up with new sounds on synthesizers or on, you know, new combinations of percussion and so forth. So all of that, you know, has sort of just been what I've been into my whole life. And as I've heard different music from around the world, you know, be it African or Brazilian or, you know, Turkish, Hungarian, whatever it is, I've kind of just been fascinated by the way that people can burn in a way that's not familiar to me. And I took my kids to... the Huck Finn Jubilee, this huge, great outdoor bluegrass festival one year, and just was blown away by how great the people played and how great they sang. You know, there was a band called Rhonda Vincent and the Rage there that if you haven't heard them, you owe it to yourself to hear them. And they get up there and they're just tearing it up, and this violinist is playing all these incredible lines. I guess I call him a fiddle player in this universe, but they weren't jazz lines, and I was so struck by his ability to compose this 8-measure capsule of perfect music and stick the landing and be out. And I told my kids, you know, man, I think I would have trouble trying to be that concise and that perfect and to, you know, speak that language like that. And then they started singing, and the singing is like these 4 laser beams that just come straight out at you. And I'm used to, you know, people with a lot of, you know, inflection on the note and vibrato and stuff. And I was just so struck by the sound of it that I said, I'm going to get into that music some more. So I've been a listener ever since. That's kind of what prompted me to just kind of see if I could pick these guys' brains a little bit.
Oh, that's very cool. I appreciate that. And also the fact that I know you've had a long career, but you're interested still in expanding your horizons and trying something new, and you too continue to learn. So that's great. So let's maybe turn the microphone over to Bryan Sutton, who is our flat pick guitar teacher at ArtistWorks. He also heads up the largest course at ArtistWorks. He's been teacher of the year too many years. Last year, we just sent him a bottle of bourbon.
There you go, Bryan.
Isn't there like an every 3-month kind of version of this prize?
Yeah, we should do that. Well, tell us a little bit about yourself, Bryan.
Okay, thanks, Patricia. I grew up in Western North Carolina, and grew up in a musical family. Very fortunate to sort of literally sort of be raised by and within a community of musicians that play primarily old-time mountain music. I think a lot of modern folks might not call it bluegrass specifically, but it has bluegrass elements, and a lot of it are, you know, sort of proto bluegrass elements, meaning sort of old Scots-Irish sort of fiddle tunes, and, you know, within that tradition is storytelling and ballad singing and dancing and things like that. And that was a lot of what I experienced as a kid growing up. I had a grandfather that played fiddle and a dad that's a great musician, multi-instrumentalist, and And like I say, there was a community, players all around me, folks my age, kids that I was able to hang out with and play music, and then folks that were three times my age that were friends. And we all, again, just played a lot of music. And that's the primary sort of nugget of me musically is that, to George's point, sort of that American folk music, that American folk tradition, which already is kind of a fusion of different things. And as it sort of translates into bluegrass and, you know, brings in some other elements. As I became of an age to kind of, you know, start thinking about a career in music, I knew that, you know, playing bluegrass was something I always wanted to be around, but not necessarily was driven to try to just be, you know, a soloist or, go find a band and hit the road for the rest of my life. So I've always been drawn to working in recording studios. And so a big chunk of the last 25 to 30 years has had me, and I live here in Nashville now, but I started in Western North Carolina and various places around there. But basically kind of being a musician for hire, playing guitar, but also playing pretty much a lot of kind of traditional American sounds on stringed instruments like mandolins and fiddles and dobros and banjos. And that's been a lot of what I've managed and balanced for the last, again, 25 plus years is live bluegrass playing, hanging out with guys like Mike Marshall, thankfully, and kind of doing that, but also having this sort of side or another side of that career of being in Nashville and working as a session player. And very fortunate to have kind of planted strongly around here and played on a bunch of records over the last 30 years that, have nothing to do with bluegrass, but still, you know, I enjoy it, to George's point again, of just being turned on by all kinds of different things. I've always wanted to be a musician without necessarily being such a chameleon, you know, find myself within all these different formats, genres, styles, traditions, cultures, whatever you want to call it, just really appreciating, you know, the fact that I can study that stuff and kind of find my own self in it and maybe find things that I can apply to something I'm writing. I think it all just helps us be healthier musicians, people in general, really. I mean, for anybody that's aspiring or not even a musician yet at all, just to go study lots of different kinds of music, just for the wide range of possibilities of what you can do with the concept of what music is as a communication is pretty amazing. So, stop here.
Yeah, well, thank you. Bryan has been the guitarist in recent years for the celebrated group Hot Rise, and everybody's doing nothing right now, but that's an important milestone in his career as well. So that leaves us with Mike Marshall, and we did not, you know, we're not ignoring you, Mike.
Oh, I know.
You have a great musical history too. And, some of your origins are legendary. So maybe walk down memory lane.
I'll encapsulate it here as best I can. I grew up, born in Pennsylvania, and was not from a musical family. We moved to Florida when I was about 11 or 12 years old and started taking guitar lessons from a local guy down the street. And it turned out that he was into bluegrass and played all the different string instruments. So right away, he turned me on to the banjo and the mandolin and the fiddle and things, and started a little teenage bluegrass band with us. So that's what really fired me up as a teenager, going to these festivals, what Bryan was talking about, and just playing the music, learning the music orally, just sitting around the campfires, sharing tunes one-on-one with folks and jamming all night long. So after going to my first bluegrass festival, the sort of top of my head came off, and I went crazy, brought back all these LPs and started transcribing music off the records, and just got sort of thrust into this whole scene. You know, in the early 70s, there was so much going on with this music. And I think what attracted me to it the most was what Bryan was talking about, but you had multiple generations connecting around the music. And you had people from very different political stripes. You had groups of hippies hanging out with farmers from the South, and the music is what drew them together, and that was the connection point. And everybody left the politics at the door, and the music was working. But I was always interested in lots of different kinds of music. Whether it was Allman Brothers or the Beatles. You know, growing up with popular music around, and I was starting to toy with the idea of jazz. And right at that point, a group on the West Coast was formed with Tony Rice, a great guitar player, and David Grisman, the David Grisman Quintet. And I was fortunate enough to move out there, meet those guys, and join the band. And that for me was like being thrust into a kind of a master's degree program. Everything about music. And to be on the West Coast, like what George was talking about, it was just a mecca of great listening going on, and all the different cultures of music were there. And so, you know, being turned on to Brazilian music and Cuban music and Indian classical music and all these different forms, and so many people fusing it together, whether you were playing electric instruments or acoustic instruments. And so that's, you know, that kind of did it for me. I got to meet my heroes and play with them, and it's just kind of launched me into this scene.
Well, we're so happy to have all of you on the roster at Artist Works. And for those of you who are joining us a little bit late, all three of these master musicians teach at Artist Works, and that's why we're kind of together today. And I'm so glad that we can be that, you know, nexus for some great musicians. So typically in these events, we let people sign in and say, here, you know, hi from wherever I am. So if you guys don't mind, maybe now we could put some of those greetings on the screen. You might know some of these folks. Susan, I'm so glad that you're doing well and back with us. She's in Michigan, and Susan attends a lot of these live events and has probably been a student of just about all of you guys, if not each one of them. You might recognize her name. And Julie is often on with us too. Thank you for checking in, Julie, from the UK. That's wonderful. We also have someone from Ireland.
I saw my buddy Oliver from right here in Germany. I'm coming at you from Wuppertal, Germany.
All right, Wuppertal. All right. So here we're getting to that one too, Mike. And here's Marianne in Lunenburg, Massachusetts. And Lucy from Georgia.
Rick Rorix from Huntsville, Alabama.
He's You're getting ahead of me, Mike. You can read faster than me.
Oh, sorry.
No, it's okay. I just, if you could put them up, I'd let you put them up.
They're great. Great students.
I've got a shill on there now.
You have a shill, do you? Okay.
My sister, Kelly.
All right, we're going to look and see. Let's find Kelly. Let's
She's
bring
right
Kelly
there.
Out.
She's a master hand clapper.
Oh.
Yes.
Come on
Stop
now.
It. There's no such thing.
Well, she keeps pestering me to use her on hand claps on a recording session.
Okay. Does that
I
have roots?
I shouldn't be laughing. It's a thing.
We're getting to it. We're getting to it.
Okay, and then there's John from Nevada right here, and All Rick right. Rorix, a name I'm very familiar with. From
Rick, howdy, Rick.
Yeah, and Santa Barbara. Lots of California people here today. That's wonderful. Sweet. And Michael, I think one thing that happened here, Michael, Ooh. I'm sorry, I had to boot him from the studio because I think one of us put up the StreamYard link instead of the Facebook link.
Uh-oh.
So we had a few people. I'm sorry that I had to literally give you the boot from the studio, but you would have ended up on air. And here's Tom Vest. This is a nice comment. I'll just put that up there while we're going down through
sweetie.
Here.
Heck.
And then, here is Kelly. Does Artist Works need a master hand clapper? That's wonderful. I love that.
If we do, you'll be the first person we call.
We are going to be calling you. That's right. And here's
200 Paolo. Lessons on clapping your hands.
It's all about the rhythm.
It's not as easy as you think.
No.
Ciao, Paolo.
It's all about the rhythm, isn't it? Yeah, and there's Paola from Italy, and Danielle from Arizona. Lots happening today in the world of Arizona. And then Tom from Atlanta has a question here, so maybe we'll be checking back with him. And then we just have like two more, maybe three, because now people are starting to type very quickly.
They like this part.
Yeah, and there's Arturo from Miami.
3 seconds of fame, huh?
Pablo from Sweden. Hello, Pablo. I wonder where in Sweden you're from. And then we have Gabby.
Israel.
From Israel.
Wow, we're all over the map today.
All right. Well, how about a little bit of music? Shall we do that? Do you guys want to play a little bit, or do you want to talk a little bit more about?
Probably what we're best at is music.
Yeah, could be. But George has a lot of good ideas and questions and things to talk about.
Yeah, one thing I think, just putting these tracks up, you know, the soloing is really sort of maybe 20% of what we do. And the rest of it is all sort of finding your place in the arrangement and you know, bringing a dimension that hopefully pricks up people's ears, but fits with things and leaves things spacious. So, you know, as it pertains to Gentle on My Mind, for example, this is a beautiful guitar track. And if we were on a session with it and, you know, the vocalist was singing, let's say.
Oh, yeah. We'd do a whole different playing style.
Exactly. And to me.
We should show that.
That's what I'm thinking, is maybe just a little bit of that. You know, as a piano player, you know, the high watermark in this style of music, of course, is Floyd Kramer. Who basically made his living being unbelievably tasteful, right, and spacious, and adding a color and adding a dimension, but not adding clutter. So when I hear this thing, one thing that I kind of hear for myself to be doing, let me get back on the piano, is, you know, there's a lot of cool harmony. I'm an admirer of the film composition of Thomas Newman. Mm-hmm. And one thing that he does often is kind of he sort of sets a pedal sound, you know, something that's ringing throughout the piece that everything else rubs against. So if I was on this thing, I wouldn't be chunking away on chords. And I think rather than feeling like I need to add more harmony, I think I would try to sort of pedal like that.
I'd love to hear that with the guitar.
Okay, let me put the guitar track up. You know, I'm basically kind of playing, and it got a little thin at one point. Maybe I would kind of consider opening it up to that.
Nice. That rolls it along. I wonder if you play very often in drummerless bands.
Not that often. I've done a fair amount of bass drum duo stuff, though.
Well, that's the thing about bluegrass, is that it's no drummer.
Exactly.
You know? So we're kind of dividing up the four limbs of the drummer between a band within the bluegrass context.
Yeah.
Because you've got the bass on the downbeats and the mandolin is doing this chop, you know. Mm-hmm. That's your backbeat, you know. So that's what I would be doing most of the time.
Why don't you do a little bit of that with the track, just sort of.
All right. Let me bring it up. And it's really just a snap, you know, it's just a pop.
Right.
You know, it's not busy. It doesn't have a lot of wicky-wacky in it. I'll show you what I might do. It's known that you don't always open and your pants free fall. Makes me tend to leave my sleeping bag and roll the band stash behind your house. It's known that I'm not shaggy. Keep it.
You got such a good groove going with it there, and it's interesting. It's like, what is it? A double time backbeat? Maybe yeah, actually the time. Yeah. Right, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you're counting it as 1, 2, 3, 4.
Well,
one,
this
two,
is
three,
it.
Four, one, two.
No, I'm counting it 1, 2, 3.
Right.
You
you're
want
on
that
the
lazy
note? Yeah.
But I'm thinking in terms of that being the backbeat. Now, I mean, you could do an arrangement where you turn it in half, and some bands do that, where you kind of, so that's half as much backbeat, but the same tempo. And that's a more modern thing to do, and some of the jam bands would be inclined to go in that direction. Playing around with the, you know, whether it's a snapping two-beat thing or almost a funk.
You're feeling in your head, 1, 2, 3, 4, Mike, instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I like to feel a 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean, the backbeat is in there, but I even talk to my students about it a lot. You'll see people tapping their foot like, and that can make it feel a little bit nervous. And it's very hard to play quickly if you're feeling it, feeling all those subdivisions, you know. Whereas if you feel half as many subdivisions, it's certainly easier to play, for instance, eighth notes. You know?
Yeah.
If you're feeling these beats, it's like it'll get away from you, right? It feels more too nervous.
I see it as the relationship from the guitar perspective, where I'm going to be kind of being somewhat of a bridge between the part that you're playing, Mike, the chop, and the bass player, which is usually,
right,
you know, the root fifth kind of thing, where I'm sort of doing both. And on that track there, again, there's not a bass. So you have me playing that part, you know, as the line is going. There's a lot of the oompahs coming from me, where if I were playing with a band,
you would
do
as
a little
much
less
that.
Of that. More of maybe what George might play as far as a little more spacious.
Thinking of it spatially. You know, bass to its thing.
You know, again, in bluegrass rhythm, and George probably has some of this experience too, where the sort of stabs that the guitar would do, or the walking, which is, you know, the bass that's a little more active than the bass is generally going to do, depending on who's playing. but that's the general weave of the guitar in that kind of groove. Is feeling that the downbeat for me is 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 3, and the mandolin's chopping. So I do feel that, and it doesn't feel really nervous. And I guess I get what you're saying with that sort of halftime thing. But for me, that just my goal is to make it all feel kind of settled and not too nervous, just as an attitude.
Of course.
You know, the more I teach here at Artist Works, the more I find myself dwelling on that issue of the time, because you can play really simply, and if the time is cool, it sounds like mastery. It sounds like you know you know what you're doing, like you're in control of the situation. I always tell my students, people don't listen to jazz to feel anxious. Like, if you listen to Dexter Gordon play the saxophone,
oh God,
he's so far behind the beat and so clearly relaxed, even if it's an up-tempo kind of thing. I find that that's as much the mission as sort of giving people notes to play. And I made a set of lessons to go even before lesson one of my thing, where we just play a blues with a pentatonic scale and focus on that thing of taking your time, sort of let the music come to you, leave a ton of space, and it sounds like you're confident, and people pick that up right away. And the way you were kind of chopping on the mandolin, and the way that the time sits on this guitar track, also, like, right away, it's just this established thing that sounds like music, and it's so easy to play on it.
Yeah. You know, well,
any style of music, you want that, where it's floating.
What you're getting at, what I like about in these conversations within genres and whatever you study, is how time sits. You know, it's all, you know, the specific measurement of a 4-beat bar, you know, doesn't care about the culture. It's just measuring time, but how you swing things and how you, you know, the attitude behind it or whatever it may be. you know, and under trying to work to understand what laying back or settling, or in the bluegrass world, you also honor the other side of that, which is that drive. You know, it's just this, it's without running away with it, it's this like really palpable kind of energy. And that's part of what you saw Rhonda Vincent the Rage doing at Huck Finn, that just parted your hair, was just this force, you know, that when, and again, when a band is doing that together, which is again, is part of the, I think the real key between folks that are playing jazz and bluegrass and want to kind of dip is from one to the other, is just, is listening and honoring that and not trying to over insist, but really feel that and be aware ultimately as listeners, as far as the timing and stuff like that.
And, you know, the idea of playing something like that, that you just played, but being relaxed while you're playing with it, I think is a big part of it too. I mean, I spent like 6 months, you know, when I was learning to play jazz, I was very uptight about it. I needed to get to where I played great and whatever. And it showed in my body language, like my shoulders would be up like this and I'm playing this. And I finally decided that I was, when I was practicing that way, I was just practicing being nervous. There, so it was a little wonder when it was time for a performance that I got out there and my, biofeedback was, I'm anxious. So I played anxious and that made me more anxious. And now my shoulders, you know, so I spent like...
Was there a teacher or was there a band or a musical situation that where the light bulb went off about that? Or was it just...
No, I think...
Playing long enough.
You know, I'm not sure what it was, but I decided to stop trying to improvise lines so much and back up and play like in piano Hannon exercises like this, and just stop if I felt myself seizing up and focus only on getting where I was relaxed. Yeah. And it took like 6 months to get where my habit was to be relaxed and breathing and not uptight and not breathing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of a, you know, a watershed moment for me or something.
Well, it's got, you know, jazz is complicated music and sometimes it's fast and it can be almost competitive between the players in the same way that bluegrass can be. And so this brings that kind of anxiety to the music. But of course, like you said, when we listen to our favorite records, it doesn't have that quality.
Yeah.
The great players, Dexter Gordon or whoever, Django Reinhardt, you know. The stuff is so in the pocket and laid back and relaxed. I mean, swinging.
Yeah.
So that's another level of challenge for.
I hate to break up this wonderful conversation.
And
I would only interrupt it with a request to play some more music.
I love that idea.
I don't think that's a bad thing, is it?
Never
that's a great thing.
And George. Provided this unbelievably funky track where he's playing all the instruments.
Tell us a little bit about what you're going to play then, and we'll get
Tell
right
Tell us about
in.
Your bass playing on this track.
Yeah.
Dear well,
God.
The thing with this track is that you know, my kids really love classic rock, and that's what we play on the car radio, car stereo. Mm. When we're driving, and I always just love it when Mrs. Robinson comes on. It's such a killer track. The way that it's spare and you know, the funky lines of it, and it kind of crosses a lot of genres. And I thought it would be interesting to see what all three of us did on this. I kind of mocked up a track. We're playing the blues on it, a blues in F. Just see what people... How the three of us approached it, how we heard our role in the ensemble, and how we would solo on it. So I made this little track that's just percussion and bass. So I'll play a little bit on it, and we'll see what it sounds like. I think...
George, I have a question for you right before
Go ahead.
You start. Is there any way you could tilt your screen down just a little bit? Because we really can't see your hands. Is that possible?
I'm sure it is. Or at least
there we go.
It is.
I'm sure. Yeah, that's
is that
perfect.
Better?
Yeah, I'm sorry
now
to interrupt.
The top of my head is cut off.
No, but
okay,
you put your head down when you play. So
okay, good. So I'll play a little bit, and what I'm going to start with here is what I would what I would do if I was comping on this tune.
Yeah, we should each do that.
Yeah, I work often with a great guitar player named Dean Brown. And Dean is one of the world's great listeners. And when we're playing rhythm stuff together, it's really fun to play with him because we come up with an interlocking part. But part of that is leaving a lot of space. You know,
sure.
it's amazing. If you got a good drummer and a good bass player, you don't have to chunk away. Just because we're sitting at our instrument doesn't mean it has to be ringing. Dean also has this funny philosophy that he's always on the watch for bar 8. Because it's like everybody's going to fill in there. And so Dean prides himself on not being the guy who has to fill in there.
Cool.
So it's just a blues in F, and I'm going to comp some, and then I'll take a little solo that's probably also going to be fairly spacious, just because that's how I hear this sort of thing. Okay, I like that little part a little bit. So if I'm doing that, Dean can figure out something, or one of you guys can figure out something.
They'll find the holes.
I did something that brings to mind a great David Sanborn quote. I found myself on this B.
Yeah, heard
and
that.
The quote from Sanborn is, if you play a wrong note, just play it again.
And it's I did that in the other one.
Exactly. Well, there was one time that I was doing a gig with him, and I missed the form or something like that, and I played a rather conspicuously wrong chord. And we get off the stage, and I said, Dave, I'm just doing what you told me to do. I played the wrong note, and I played it again. He's like, no.
Yeah, I love it. That caught my ear. I was like, I want that note. What is that note?
I remember going to a saxophone repair shop. No, it was actually the Kyleworth Saxophone Company in Germany. Mm-mm. And amazing place. You know, they make these great saxophones. And the last stage is this guy who does the engravings. Mm. And he does it just by hand. He has this chisel and he cuts the stuff in. And I asked him, what do you do if you make a mistake? And he goes, oh, I just mix this into a flour or something. And that's a lot of what we do. You know, you get yourself, you're like Wile E. Coyote and you're out over the cliff. And you got to make something good out of it.
That's it.
Great. We should come back to that.
Training.
We should come back to that. You know, we talked about sort of groove and pocket and things like that. And what you just brought up, George, as far as, again, thinking about this sort of bluegrass and jazz either difference or similarities, conversation. You know, note choice when you're improvising, you know, bluegrass and fiddle music, American folk music, whatever you want to look at, how you want to call it, you know, is a little more simplistic than you know, a lot of jazz heads are going to be. But it doesn't necessarily mean that one has to, they have to be sort of mutually exclusive. And I think it's a deep well and interesting conversation. I'd love to hear what you say about some of that. But anyway, we're playing music now.
Yes. It's your turn, Bryan.
Oh, it is? Okay, cool.
Sure.
Well, we're in the key of F, and as you were just talking about sort of listening to bass and drums, I was thinking like what I would do on a session or just, you know, playing live. And normally, you know, I was going to play this in sort of open F, but just thinking about where I feel like I might be able to kind of lay with what those bass and drums are doing a little more, I think I'm going to more kind of traditional guitar E, which, again, what I'm doing now is sort of splitting my brain from not necessarily total bluegrass guy to sort of session guy here, and again sort of maybe multi-genre kind of approach here. So I'm thinking about players like Jerry Reed, you know, and then sort of that great kind of clavinet playing of Stevie Wonder, and just that funky stuff, you know, James Brown, all that sort of thing, and listening also to the bass, you know, from a bluegrass perspective, there's a lot of and so I like the sort of counter of, you know, the sort of release of that on, I guess, on beat two. Of the bass players I can get right.
That just sounds unbelievable.
It's
though
so
my
bad.
God, you know, and any four bars of this ideas you threw out there, we could write a tune around it if we were in the studio together.
Yeah, well, I mean, I love every bit of that. I mean, as far as, again, I'm totally happy to sit and play fiddle tunes the rest of my life, but to sit in with, and that's, you know, to some of my concepts of timing and where I learned to sort of settle. Mike asked you that question. Was it a teacher? For me, it's been great drummers and bass players that are able to play grooves like that. And I'm able to experiment with and just find, again, sort of where, to your point of playing with a guitar player, where is that little weave of different people doing different things? And then again, there's going to be moments where you just, for me, I love it. You sort of all lunge onto the same thing. That's part of that bluegrass energy too, of where we're just lunging at it.
Yeah, and
taking it for all it's worth.
I think people pick up on like that sort of joyful thing of the interplay of like, oh man, you're kicking my butt with that part. I'm going to get on it with this complimentary thing. And the whole thing gets jacked up a level. And with a good audience, like, they're tuned right in, and, you know, it's part of what's so fun about it. A lot of the stuff you played also was kind of not really even pitched. It was just like a, playing with a great percussionist with great ideas. Mm-hmm. And that makes it easy for a piano player to fit in there, because that's not so much an option with us. But we can add a little bit of harmony in there, and, you know, boy, it would be fun if we were doing this together.
I know. Well, that's coming. Two fingers out there. I'm also using a pick and two fingers. That's that Mrs. Robbins thing, right?
Yeah.
You know, that's,
there it is.
There's that sort of vibe too, which I'm not sure.
But that Jerry Reed thing.
The Jerry Reed, I mean, for anybody that wants to study how to, you know, as far as acoustic guitar with feels like that, it's just so hard to beat his funkiness. Leo Kottke's another one that just has this great just thumb and backbeat and just subdivision. I'm a sucker.
Mandolin, how would it fit over this?
Yeah, I was just going to
ask
that.
It doesn't. It doesn't, Mike. Sorry.
It doesn't work. Sorry. Okay, see you guys later. No, I've had the good fortune to play with some great drummers too and percussionists, and so I've had to devise ways to use the mandolin. And like I said, the groups that I was in, some of them didn't have drums, most of them didn't. And so we were always looking for ways to be drummers. And the mandolin is very much suited towards playing rhythmically. Sort of a cross between what Bryan was doing, and sometimes I think of it as like a conga, you know. Put the track on and I'll just play around. I'm also playing a lot on just the bottom two strings, probably imitating what you're doing on the piano sometimes when you just get two fingers going between each other, or
a pair of
double stops or something.
It's funny, everyone I know who plays funky piano, there's something going on in the left hand that's anchoring the right hand. It's a it's a variant of clavinet playing to some extent. Right. We're not meant to hear it, and we don't want the bass player lobbing a beer bottle at our head, because we're you know, so we're just poking at it.
Right.
The other thing about
the ghost notes.
Right. Exactly. The other thing about this track is that, I kind of without thinking about it, I put a lot of backbeat on the eighth, sort of the way that you were doing on the first tune.
Yeah.
Because I hear the time on this one as 1, 2, 3, 4, like slow way.
Yeah, sure.
Even though the energy is more double time than that.
Yeah, it's got both layers happening. Let me give it a go. Let's see what happens. An amazing track. I mean, you can read the phone book over that thing. It's
you know,
gonna sound fine.
Some of the stuff that you were doing in there, I wonder, like, you started out going like that sort of, you know, D and A flat, sort of that weird funky 13th.
Yeah.
Is that something that you would do if you were playing a blues more in a
bluegrass
genre?
No, that was just a mistake.
And you played it more than twice.
No, that was a mistake because I thought it was an E because Bryan was playing an E.
Oh, because it was funny as all hell.
Because he was capoed.
Yeah, and I do something.
And you dug
like
it?
I did.
Are you crazy?
Like, that's a voicing that I would use, you know, something
wow.
just to twist cool. it up a little bit. And, you know, with a good soloist, they'll hear that as a provocation and take off from there. Okay.
The mandolin is pitched so high that, yeah, that would put it in the upper partial range.
Yeah.
That's why capo has no room outside of bluegrass.
That is very funny.
Yeah, that's
sharp
cool.
9 and a 13, sure.
Wow, that was really interesting. I really enjoyed that, and all of the comments are very positive about your collaboration here. And one gentleman I happen to agree with him thought that this would be a great idea to do on Artist Works, where you take a tune, and you know a bunch of schools talk about how they would play their part in their genre. It might be
you know
really
we could upload this track,
yeah,
and do a bit of lessons.
Everybody.
Yeah, because it's a little bit of a genre-bending thing, you know?
Yeah.
It's not really jazz and...
Get Tony Trischka on it. And
absolutely.
Get your sax and...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that'd be... Eric Marienthal, you bet. That'd really be great. That'd be a lot of fun.
Sure.
So I know that you guys have talked a lot about different styles and everything, which is fantastic, and I wondered if you could take a moment and just talk a little bit about... the differences in improvisation, and I know this is a massive subject, I know it is, but Bryan taught a lot about improvisation, and George, you gave me a moment of clarity on improvisation for jazz, and so I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about the difference between jazz and bluegrass improvisation. Is that an okay thing to chat about?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's, you know, I mean, any of these styles, you know, have their, God, it's a deep well, you're right. But I think the main thing to remember about improvising within a style is the first sort of step is to learn the melodies of the tunes within the style that you're trying to play in. Like if you want to play jazz, learn jazz tunes, right? And then if you're going to try and jump over to bluegrass, learn those fiddle tunes that are really the heart of the music and give you the language and the sort of sentence structure and the rhythmic structure of how the music is spoken. Brazilian music, you know, me having dove into that well a little bit that I have, at first it was such a mystery. I was trying to shoehorn my bluegrass licks or my jazz licks into Brazilian music. But you need to learn the rhythmic framework of those syncopations by learning those melodies. That would be my recommendation anyway. Obviously it's much more than that, but that's kind of a starting point.
It is. I think it is a good starting point. And I know, Bryan, you have a different approach to improvisation specifically for guitar, obviously. What do you think the distinction between bluegrass improvisation and jazz really is? What do you see the big differences there?
Well, to be totally honest, I mean, as far as the spirit of improvisation, the willingness to kind of put yourself out there and try things,
they're not that different.
It's not, yeah, the heart of it, and as far as the listening that's involved, that's encouraged in any kind of improvisation, that is a lot of time that requires a lot of, you know, sometimes self introspective kind of, you know, what is getting in my way, you know, what are the ego or the expectations that I've set upon myself, like Mike said, trying to insist upon his bluegrassness in this Brazilian world. And, you know, am I committing myself as much as I can to really kind of giving in, making this agreement with the music, with myself? And I mean, that's a huge, deep sort of meta well to get into as far as like what I like to encourage folks within the world of bluegrass. And Mike touched on it. It comes down to the melodies. I think a lot of people think improvisation is about blowing over changes. And to an extent, it is. And that's part of what you can study. And that within that is built, you know, learning your instrument. And as far as acoustic guitar, and also just as George would say, playing how he plays different on a keyboard than he would an acoustic piano. You know, the voice in this resonant chamber and really using notes that can sustain, or, you know, how the high end, the higher notes have low end when you're really, you know, working for that resonance. And that's all part of the listening process that does, you know, hopefully inspire good improvisational moments. So that's main thing one, is really learning your instrument and appreciating what it can do and what you can do to optimize that. And then again, back to the music itself, as far as within bluegrass. And it's not that jazz players shouldn't or couldn't do this, but for me, what I like to do is sort of feel like that I am, and John Hartford, again, to kind of touch on him, he had a great statement called playing with, he wanted to play with the melodies. And so the way I encourage folks to do that is to really, you know, kind of get off the instrument for a second, sort of the opposite of what I just said earlier, and really get to a point where you can vocalize these melodies. You know, that's what fiddle tunes are great for, because if at first glance, a lot of them really do sort of sound the same. It's a lot of just streams of eighth notes in a fairly diatonic kind of major scale manner. But within that, when you really start unpacking, to Mike's again point about within the culture and really kind of looking at what's really there, and again, to the, having the goal to be able to vocalize that, you know, being able to really know these tunes, that both of those working together provide for me what I really want to encourage everyone, at least in the bluegrass world that I deal with, to really see as a balance for your improvisation, which is this blending of fluency on the instrument and feeling like that you're not going to hit a wall anywhere. And I know a lot of bluegrass players sort of spend a lot of time down here in first position and don't really venture much past that because of the capo. But anyway, the point is that when you can understand the structure, and again, for my point, really being able to vocalize melodies and kind of internalize these things, that's, for me, that's where you get to this blend, hopefully, of, you know, I have a statement that I make is if somebody just walked in the middle of a solo, they would still basically know what song I'm playing. That's a thing that I encourage as far as, and again, I don't think it's exclusive to bluegrass at all, but I do feel like there's a, at least for me, I like that kind of elusive target of how can I be completely me in this song, but still serve the song in a way that at least for me, honors it in a way that communicates it to somebody.
Good thoughts.
You know, in my Artist Works lessons, it's in there somewhere that I said, if you want to make like an old master jazz guy smile, quote the melody a little bit in the middle of your solo. And then, you know, Elvin Jones to me is my favorite jazz drummer, hands down. Kind of my favorite drummer, period. And I saw Elvin play a whole bunch at the Village Vanguard. He played kind of every Thanksgiving. And when he plays, he's constantly, he's got this kind of grinding sound that he's doing with his mouth. He's like, like this. And he's playing. And, you know, we just assumed that I do it. Everybody sort of vocalizes when they play. But somebody told me that what that is Elvin singing the melody. Wow. Of the tune. Like when he's blowing, he's so mindful of what the song is that he's kind of singing there the melody. Go. Elvin had there a range of like a minor second, so it didn't sound like the melody of the tune.
But he's hearing it.
Definitely. And he's that mindful of what song they're playing, even though there some of the songs weren't, you know, how much is that doggy in the window? They were, you know, John Coltrane's intense, you know, stuff. Just to touch on the topic, I often do a lesson for people where I show, you know, how I would play on something. I always use New York State of Mind because it's a good example of the stuff you can cover. And just show them like the one scale that you can play the whole tune with. So it's in B flat, or at least I play it in B flat. And the scale I would use is a G blues scale. And I wouldn't run all my jazz scales and all my substitutions and stuff like that. I mean, Phil Woods sure did that beautifully on Just the Way You Are. But, you know, we can play. Mm-hmm. you know, we can play the whole tune with that, and it sounds idiomatically correct. So,
and that, but isn't that because of the rhythms and the syncopations as much as the notes?
Right, and you know, I'm greasing things heavily.
Yeah. But see, George, you have this da 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 da, but you also have this da 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 da, like layers of rhythms.
Yeah.
That are in your bones at this point.
Kind of, yeah. And you know, we want to sort of keep it rolling again, being relaxed about it. I'm trying to do my best impression of Alan Toussaint or. Yeah. You know, Dr. John or Billy Payne is another great one on piano. Oh, yeah. And just that, but all I did, I didn't play any notes there that weren't a G blues scale. And it sounds more right to my ears than it would. So I think sort of understanding the country you're in and speaking that language, mm-hmm. rather than, you know, showing up at a French restaurant in Paris and speaking English real loud. It's like what you were talking about, trying to bring your thing and just drape it on to something that isn't that world. And I find it really expansive to spend some time playing with people who play a different kind of music, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I come back to jazz and I play it a little bit differently than I did.
That's right.
You know, in all of these live events, I've talked to a lot of our artists, and so many people have said, especially during this time when we're at home, that they're listening to music that they normally don't play. And it is sort of expanding their horizons and influencing their playing style a little bit. So I find that interesting that the things are happening as we find ourselves at home a little more frequently and have that mental space to just listen a little bit more to other music. We are
don't say it. What are you saying? Yeah. You're not going to say we're out of time, are you?
We are not ever out of time with you guys.
We have a question, though. Did you want to answer a question?
Yes, I was just...
It's a very good question.
Yeah, I'm going to have you as my co-pilot all the time.
I'm just reading here.
I really appreciate it. No, thank you so much. There are actually
sorry
two questions
to get
here. No, not at all. I do, before we go to the questions, want to remind everybody that we do have a contest, a really awesome contest going on.
Oh, yeah.
Take a look at the scroll because you can get 60 minutes with one of these guys. And learn a lot in that amount of time. So Susan, I'm sorry, let's go to this question first. The minutiae, I don't know.
Yeah, Django,
I don't know. Okay.
It's gypsy jazz,
Oh, that's why it's unfamiliar to me. You want to have a quick conversation about that, guys? Maybe, maybe not.
Take that, Mike.
No, well, you know, that's the music of Django Reinhardt and Stefan Grappelli. It was really at the heart of it. And it's something that super inspired me for a long time. I learned a bunch of those tunes, and still to this day when I have a chance to play it with guys who really know how to play it.
What's
I mean, it's
different
another
about
world,
it,
you know?
Yeah, what's different about it?
Yeah, it's, you know, it's Django Reinhardt was a gypsy, and so they were super inspired by jazz. They were really inspired by Joe Venuti and Eddie Lang, right? American string jazz players. And but they had this gypsy music sort of background in the way they approached jazz. So there's always been arguments in the jazz world as to whether it really was jazz, you know. But of course, they were trying to copy Louis Armstrong and all the greats that they had heard.
But heavy use of the arpeggios. It's a lot of adding different rhythms to arpeggios, it sounds like.
Well,
what do you
have
to say, Brian?
I think what she's getting at, it's using arpeggios can be, to George's point, of sort of finding a scale that you can work within. you know, having arpeggios as sort of a starting block for what can lead you to lines and musical discovery. I think, you know, again, it can kind of work in different ways. This, and what could work in a song like, what were you just playing? Swing 51. You know, that the same kind of, you know, an arpeggiated sort of approach would work in Building in Low Ground, you know, if that were. I may be missing it, but that to me, that's when I've heard arpeggios referred to as far as thinking about improvisation. And I know in the gypsy music, there's the flurries of things that they do that are arpeggios as well. But to the bigger the discussion here about, you know, pathways to improv within these different styles, you can use that. Again, that's part of, again, my little point that I tried to make earlier as far as understanding what's on your instrument, and to George's point of, here's a scale that encapsulates all these chords in this song. Here are, you know, in a song like Swing 51, just like in the fiddle tune of Building the Low Ground, here's the major scale of C, and all the little triads and our potential arpeggios within those triads can get musical stuff going that will sound better than just nebulous, very scalar kind of, you know, kind of things like that. And I think that's where that's headed. But I mean, I guess the bottom line, to try to endorse anything about it, I think there are several methods within sort of music theory, if you want to call it that, that can lead folks to experience something more musical and more expressive than just sounding too technical. And I think that's, again, George's first point, or his, you know, as he said before, even lesson one, let's just lay back with a pentatonic scale just to sort of experience a feel and an experience more than just a conscious kind of awareness of what should come next.
Isn't that also a little flavor of what we were discussing in the sound check, in that when you do improvise, you don't need to play absolutely every single note, every single lick and riff that you know, that it's about choosing the right vocabulary to have a great conversation. I mean, isn't that sort of what you're saying, that you could play a whole bunch of eighth notes or 16th notes and all the members of the scale, but that's maybe not quite so musical?
Well, you know, again, it's, to me, it comes down to sort of some context, and it's subjective, because again, in bluegrass, if Mike and I are playing Lonesome Fiddle Blues at 135 beats a minute, there's going to be a lot of eighth notes flying around. but hopefully that he and I are both at a point where we're going to enjoy the other side of that too at some point in the experience. So I feel like it's all has worth at the end of the day as far as possibility. But I think to your point of like speaking the language or having a musical conversation, again, I think there are many pathways to this. Arpeggios can be one of those. As far as to your, I mean, did you say, Patricia, sort of what's appropriate? Did you bring that up? Was that you that said that earlier?
Yeah, it's just like any conversation, it's valuable to be listening.
Yeah.
And it's important to not control the conversation all the time. It shouldn't be competitive, like Susan has said in some of the comments. It really should be a give and take conversation, it seems. And so if you're playing every single note and every single lick and every riff that you know, there's no room.
I think that's where we choose to play with the musicians we choose to play with, because they have a sense about this and we're in connection.
Exactly.
What works and what doesn't. And you know, you'll get called back for the gig if you're not sucking all the air out of the room.
Yeah,
I've always told people, if you want to get on some good gigs, it's going to be more important how you play in the ensemble, how you play behind the leader, than you light everybody up with these great solos. On the topic of you know, sort of that school of jazz, though, if you haven't seen Borelli Legrand's band play, unbelievably on fire. Like, you just can't, you know, anytime I see he's at a festival, I always time myself so that I get to catch that set.
And talk about a lot of notes. but
talk about the most unbelievable notes you ever heard.
That's the spirit of that music. Just like it is, you know, again, when you see a really tight bluegrass band that's just burning. I mean, that's
they're pushing
the spirit,
each other.
That's the fire that you have.
Yeah.
There's a lot of similarities in gypsy swing and bluegrass, just from the, you know, just the energy of it and the literal just spirit and spark that's in both sort of forms of music.
Is it competitive? Yes, but it's also joyful. You know, you hear your buddy do something amazing, you want to do it too. You know, it's not like you're trying to trounce him. You just are caught up in the joy and spirit of the music, where it's going, and you want to be on that ride.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the bands that I play with often is Chris Ming Doki's band, The Nomads. It's me and Dave Weckl and Dean Brown, the guitar player I was talking about, and Chris plays bass. And we had this realization a few tours back, a few years ago, that none of us really wants to be the soloist. The fun thing is being part of the ensemble and getting the ensemble to cook.
Right.
And that's such
first
a great,
things first.
It's such a great listening band. When I play with bands like that, you know, a lot of it is kind of electric, funky jazz. I've kind of just developed a habit of starting out with a little bit of motivic stuff, mm-hmm. just and very sparse, and people can get right in mm-hmm. behind me, and we sort of set a tone and try to take it somewhere else by, you know, playing something a little provocative, like if we're doing the Mrs. Robinson track, and I'm playing on it, I, you know, maybe just to give people a chance to sort
purposely
of
purposely leave holes for them.
Exactly. And then it turns into this other thing, and they're feeding you ideas, and the next thing you know, you're doing something different than you would. So
there's your space. Oh boy, what's that?
You made another mistake, Mike.
What is that? Please explain.
I could show you that in 1 minute. It's McCoy Tyner.
Yeah.
It's voicings that are based in fourths, right? So fourths that, right, you got it. And then, but then down below that, and then take the bottom notes up or down a half step, and you get this sort of more exotic, weird.
Just the top, the bottom or top.
Yeah, you keep the top note where it is, because that's sort of your anchor thing. You don't want it to sound like you're, yeah.
Both of the bottom notes or just the lowest?
Well, on piano, I'm actually playing five note voicings here. No, there's no A, it's go down a fourth from there.
I can't.
Well, you know, what you need is a hip shot.
I'm going to get a fifth string on this man.
On your mandolin.
Oh,
anyway,
my
but that idea of getting the band involved with you, it really transforms the whole thing to mm-hmm. have everyone working on the improvisation instead of people like basically looking at their watch and playing mm-hmm. a rhythm
yeah,
track.
Yeah.
Behind you.
Well, there's one of those distinctions that you come, I'm sorry, there's one of these distinctions that happen like in a bluegrass jam or a fiddle tune jam. There's that same level of listening, but it's I think just a little more activity, would you say, Mike, in general? Again, if we're just thinking of five of us on stage playing,
really going at it,
ride the wild turkey.
Yeah.
And, but you know, there's still that interactive thing, but it's not so much about space maybe, but still about healthy reaction and give and take, and nobody's really trying to be the star.
Once it's grooving and the gears have all fixed into each other, then there's places. It just floats by itself at a certain point.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it transcends. Define it.
It is a lesson for a lot of bluegrass players to be able to, okay, just stop for, take a breath for a second, you mm-hmm. know, just somewhere in there, just, you know, even as you're listening and reacting, just allow that float to happen. You
I'll
know,
never forget playing Rocky Grass with you when Dennis Crouch was on bass.
Yeah.
We had that groove going so good. At one point, he just stopped playing. And the thing just kept going. And I was like, wow, have you ever seen a bass player stop, you know?
I love the guy that will do that.
It is just, it was, everything was fine, you know?
That's an amazing thing that you said, Bryan, in that you said, take a breath.
Yeah.
And isn't that the truth in some conversations where, oh, you know, Lordy, there's somebody that just will not stop. And
you
think, I've heard somebody, a spouse, say to another spouse, take a breath, you know, like just stop talking.
It's enough about me. Can we talk about my movie?
So I would love to hear another musical conversation between the three of you as we kind of close out our event today. We are absolutely going to have to do this again. I've thoroughly enjoyed this.
And for those of you who are wondering why we're not jamming together, if you don't understand the technology of sending a signal up to a satellite and back down and moving it over to L.A., it takes a second
through
to
Russia
get there.
Too.
Through Russia. It takes a while to get there, and so by the time I hear what Brian's doing, I'll be playing late, and it would sound terrible, which is too bad. Someday maybe they'll get this technology.
I hope so. And I've heard some people talking about some software, but I've tried it, and it's still not
quite there.
But so, what would you like to do to kind of close out our event before we say goodbye to everyone?
We have another rhythm track to play.
Okay,
too.
What is it?
This is a tune I heard Bryan Sutton record with, was it Ronnie McCurry on mandolin?
Yeah, I did it right here in the basement, in the hole.
Oh, Lordy, what a track it was, too. Just mandolin and guitar by Bill Monroe. Bill Monroe wrote it, I guess, for Doc Watson, huh?
Yeah, he kind of, the main guitar theme in this, and this is Mike playing guitar here, sort of led into the rest of what is this melody that Bill wrote inspired by Doc Watson. Doc always had this, you know, thing that he would do, these low runs, you know, he would play Deep River Blues, you know. It was just always, he would always put the exclamation point. So Bill Monroe wrote a whole song around that basic idea. And maybe you should play it first, since you know that's authentical and stuff.
I'll give it a go. That's right. That's how it sounded on the original. A little Watson blues.
Blues for the guitar. One, two, one. Thank you. blues.
Oops, sorry.
Starting to stop
That's
now.
Great. All right.
Beautiful.
Good job, Mike.
Peace, huh?
Who is next, Bryan?
I'll play a little bit on it.
Yeah,
George.
Do it, George.
I vote for George.
I'm tempted to play a little synthesizer thing on here and do my best.
You're bending.
Well, sort of try to fill the space that a fiddle player might play.
Nice.
So maybe I'll do that. It's not going to sound like what we expect, but I love to do this stuff. I think it's part of what attracts me to the fiddle player is that, you know, my monophonic synth thing is one of my favorite things to do.
Nice.
So.
One, two, one.
With Matt Guitar Murphy's band.
Too
Matt
cool.
used to love it. Just, you know, the weirder the shit, the better. Yeah.
Hey, George.
Yeah.
Are you you're familiar with Vassar Clements?
Yeah.
Just the way you were kind of, on that synth, the way it kind of opens up into those harmonics is the way he would play that, where it sort of turned into its own little feedback. And that's, and a lot of what you were playing was very much out of the Vassar playbook.
Yeah.
You know, it was really cool.
Absolutely. This particular synthesizer has I don't have the audio plugged in, but there's a bunch of sounds in there that have like a ring modulator on it or something, so that you touch it and it's not quite what you expect, but it's like the machine has an idea for you.
Yeah.
And the weird harmonics, like you just, it again, it forces you out of your box. So,
very cool.
Man. It inspires me. I wish if I had 10 more minutes, I would go get it. One of the sort of COVID things that I've done with my daughter upstairs is stick a MIDI pickup onto a Strat that she plays. And I've been triggering these little Mellotron flutes.
Oh, cool.
In GarageBand. And it would,
very
be,
cool.
it would be perfect for that.
Yeah.
Well, Bryan, do you want to take a turn around the barn with this one?
I'll do it. Right. Here we go.
One. Thank you.
Come get you.
You can't do that.
You cannot do that right there.
That was great. Yeah.
Very cool.
You guys are good. I wanna thank you so much for spending an hour and a half with us. Thank you, Bryan. Thank you, George. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Patricia.
A pleasure.
I'm happy to this is just great.
Thank you, Artist Works, for providing place.
Absolutely.
Get together like this.
I'm thanking David, even though he's in the other room, because I feel very, very privileged to know all of you and to just be the recipient of your talent and the steward of your teaching. And I'm really happy to be doing these kind of events with you guys. This was really wonderful. Hour and a half.
This was a good one.
Just really appreciate it. Thank you
so much.
It's
been a wacky week. I think all of us needed this.
Yeah,
we can get back on track here.
If we could just point out for one second that this interchange of ideas is a little bit similar to what ArtistWorks does with the video exchanges.
Yeah,
it's true.
People send in video of themselves playing, and they get back, you know, a live video of us discussing what's going on, and it's kind of conversational in that way.
It is.
So
yeah. Yeah, it is. It's a two-way conversation, and that's the genius of what David has figured out for all of us. And I like that it's asynchronous, because then, you know, the guys over, you know, in Belgium can record whenever they want, and Bryan can be in his Nashville time. So it's okay. It's good, and we really love being able to teach the world music, but we wouldn't be able to do it without you guys. So I want to really thank you for doing that. And I hope that we get a bunch of people who are interested in having these 1 hour lessons. But if not, I have certainly enjoyed this hour and a half, and looking forward to possibly doing some kind of collaboration like this again. So we'll bid farewell for the time being, but we do have other live dispatches from home coming up. So please just keep an eye on our Facebook, also on our YouTube channel and Instagram. We make sure to tell everybody all about it. So thank everybody from around the world for spending some time with us today.
Yeah, way to go. Right.
Thanks, see everybody.
All right, George, great
soon.
To meet you.
See you guys later. Pleasure to meet both of you, too.
Someday in person, soon.
Absolutely. I will definitely drive up for that.
All right. You got it.
Cool.
Sounds good. Take care, all.
Yep. See you later.
Cheers.
Bye.